Good morning, and welcome to the Church of St. Paul in the Desert in Palm Springs. It is great to be back in person in worship in the sanctuary. We are happy to have you here, those of you who've joined us today. And if you are at home, we hope that you're comfortable. My name is Steve Moore, and it is my privilege to serve the church as the senior warden. We have a couple of announcements to make and a few simple instructions on the worship service. First, the camping ministry is planning a camping trip to Burton Flats from June 21st to the 23rd. Please see the bulletin, newsletter, or our Facebook page for detailed information. The book club is still meeting via Zoom, and the next meeting will be on June 8th at 1 p.m. Information on how to take part in that and the link to connect is also in the newsletter and on the website. We are excited that the search for our new rector is in its final stages. The vestry and search committees have already met with two candidates and will be going into discernment later this month. We hope that we will be able to announce the next rector for our church by the 1st of July. You will be updated on the website as soon as more information is available, and your prayers are greatly appreciated. Even though we are not at full capacity today in worship, we ask that you make a prior reservation, if possible, on the website or by phone call to the office. If you forget to make a reservation and there is seating available, we will be happy to take you in, but we do encourage you to make those reservations in advance. We will soon have live stream equipment finished in the church, and then we will be able to bring worship service to you every weekend, wherever you may be. Here are a few simple instructions for today's service. We still require masks in California and 6-foot distancing. We cannot allow congregational singing, but the words to the music are in your bulletin, so you can follow along. You can sing at home, or if you're here, you can hum under your mask. Please follow the directions of the service volunteers when it is time for communion. You'll be asked to follow in one direction around the church to come to the communion rail to receive the host in your hand. Once you have received the bread, then you may return to your seat and drop your mask to consume the host. When the service concludes, please remain seated until the postlude. After that, you'll be given instructions on exiting the church on the west side, and there's a plate where you can leave your communion or your offering today at that time. Again, we welcome you back into the church and thank you for your cooperation as we gather to praise and thank God in worship. Now please stand and join me as we say together our mission statements together. God has invited us to share the abundant life of Jesus Christ through the Church of St. Paul in the desert, by serving Christ and others, and by gathering to praise and thank God in worship. We are a welcoming, empowering, supportive community. The Episcopal Diocese of San Diego is a missionary community that dares to follow Jesus Christ in his life of fearless love for the world. Thank you very much and enjoy the service.
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you have given to us your servants grace by the confession of a true faith to acknowledge the glory of the eternal Trinity and in the power of your divine majesty to worship the unity. Keep us steadfast in this faith and worship, and bring us at last to see you in your one and eternal glory. O Father, who with the Son and Holy Spirit live and reign, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on the throne, high and lofty, and the hems of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The pivots on the threshold shook, and the voices of those whom called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. And the seraph touched my mouth and with it said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
God. Due to COVID restrictions, the psalm will be read by the congregation, and the quartet will sing the refrain. Upon the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord is upon the mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is a powerful voice. The voice of the Lord is a voice of splendor. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedar trees. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon.
Ascribe to the Lord the glory of his name.
He makes Lebanon skip like a calf, and Mount Hermon like a young wild ox. The voice of the Lord splits the flames of fire. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord makes the oak trees writhe and strips the forests bare. And in the temple of the Lord, all are crying, glory. The Lord sits enthroned above the flood. The Lord sits enthroned as King forevermore. The Lord shall give strength to his people. The Lord shall give his people the blessing of peace.
Ascribe to the Lord the glory of his name.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. So then, brothers and sisters, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very Spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs with God, and joint heirs with Christ. If, in fact, we suffer with him so that we may also be glorified with him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now there was a Pharisee named Nicodemus, a leader of the Jews. He came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do apart from the presence of God." Jesus answered him, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God without being born from above." Nicodemus said to him, "How can anyone be born after having grown old? Can one enter a second time into the mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God without being born of water and spirit. What is born of the flesh is flesh, and what is born of the spirit is spirit. Do not be astonished that I said to you, you must be born from above. The wind blows where it chooses, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you a teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Very truly, I tell you, we speak of what we know and testify to what we have seen, yet you do not receive our testimony. If I have told you about earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except the one who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Trinity Sunday. Let me just begin by saying, if by the time that I am done with my sermon, I have explained the Trinity to you, then I have committed a heresy. There is no way that I can explain that to you because it is a mystery. So please, if at the end of it you're like, "I totally get it," just don't write the bishop. Just pretend this never happened. Friends, we are imperfect. We are imperfect beings, and because of that, sometimes words just aren't enough. Words fail us, which is why sometimes when the words aren't enough, we turn to beautiful music, like what our choir sings. When we can't say in words, we sometimes try to put to music. Sometimes we do it in other forms of art, in architecture. We do it in paintings. And sometimes, when words fail us, a simple human touch is enough to say, "I love you and I am here even though you suffer." So then, what to make of the Trinity? The words that we as humans have are not enough to explain this Trinity thing. This thing about three in one, where one ends, the other one begins, and yet they're separate, and yet they're the same. Perhaps I present to you, this is an example of what our life with God should be like. Now, let's talk about Nicodemus, shall we? Nicodemus was a Pharisee. In other words, he was a legal scholar of the law. He was a detailed follower of the law. The law, as you might recall, are the first five books of what we call the Old Testament, the Hebrew Scriptures. Everything you needed to live your life was meant to be in those first five books. And so there were Pharisees around so that they could actually try to expand on what was written in those five books for every possible scenario. I'll give you an example. There are rules that come from those things. So the law says, thou shalt keep the Sabbath holy. But that's where it ends. And so you might be left with questions. Well, what does it exactly mean to keep the Sabbath holy? How do I do that? So Pharisees were the type of people, the legal scholars, who would write down, this is exactly what it means. And they went really into detail. They had rules, for example, about tying knots. And you might be like, well, that's just weird. First of all, they're in a desert, so what's up with knots? Second of all, knots were used as a daily part of life. So you might be like, okay, I don't do a knot on the Sabbath. I can totally do that, except when you recall, in order to get water, you had to go to a well, and you brought your bucket. How did you get your bucket down to the bottom of the well? You tied a knot, except you couldn't do it on the Sabbath. So what does that mean? You can't get water on the Sabbath. So this is what Pharisees did. They looked at every aspect of life and said, how does the law of God apply to every aspect of life? And so Nicodemus says, but this Jesus guy is special. There's something about him. I get him. So he comes to him and says, I know you come from God because look at these signs and wonders that you're doing. It is obvious to everyone that you come from God. And then Jesus gives him this whole discourse about being born again. And he's like, I'm a legalist. So am I supposed to crawl back into my mom and be born again? You need to be a little bit more specific. Lawyers always around to mess it up, right? Kidding. Married to a lawyer. It's all good. But Jesus says, it's not about the signs and wonders. It's about your inner life. It's about your transformation because God is part of your life. That's it. If you are transformed by God, it will be as if though you were born again because your life will be so different. You will just see things differently. You will move differently in this world. And it'll be so different that it is being born again. So Jesus is saying the signs and wonders don't matter at all if your life is not being transformed. I can do miracles from here until my second coming. He could say that. It was him. I could do things from here until then. And you're going to believe none of it if your life is not transformed. So that's the business we're in the church, right? We're in this business of transformation. The other day, I was going through the internet, and there's this thing called clickbait, right? These like headlines that get you like, ooh, interesting headline, and you click on it, clickbait. And there was one that said, Jesus turns beer into furniture. And I'm like, well, all right, I'm in, I'll bite. Why did that happen? I like beer and I like furniture. Tell me more. So I click on it and it was one of those headlines. It really was a story about how someone who used to drink a lot found Jesus and then was able to put their lives together and became a carpenter and made furniture. So yes, by encountering Jesus, we went from beer to furniture. So I had to take some beer back to the store because apparently I can't sit on beer anymore. I was like, I'm totally ready for this. But that is what Jesus is talking about. It's about this transformation that if you encounter Jesus, your life will be different. Your life will be changed. So how do you make, quote unquote, bad people or sinful people good? Jesus' answer is love. Jesus' answer is that it is all about love. And that is what the Trinity is about. Being in relationship with each other in such a way that you can't tell where one ends and the other one begins. They're separate, but they're the same. And so maybe the invitation from Jesus is for us to sort of join that Trinity. Would it be like a quadrinity or something? Now I'm committing a heresy. No, it's only a trinity. But Jesus is inviting us into relationship with him. And in so doing, inviting us into relationship with God. in such a relationship that our life is so changed that we feel different. Now, here's what's great. I have good news for you today. In Scripture, it says, "For God so loved the world," right? We just saw it now. We've seen John 3:16 all over the place. If you look at that statement, "For God so loved the world," God is the instigator. God says, "I so love the world that I send my son." We don't have to pretend like we're the ones going and knocking and saying, "Will you be in relationship with me, God?" God is saying, "For I so love the world, I've already done that for you." We don't have to be the ones who go seeking. And how will we stay in relationship with Jesus and with God and with the Spirit? Love. Love is what binds it all together. The Trinity, I don't understand, but I do understand that it is about relationship, and that what keeps that relationship together is love. Friends, we are about relationships. How many of you watching this at home right now miss being in this place? You miss it because of the relationships. You miss it because we miss being with each other. We miss being together. That's just a small little sample of what the relationship between God and us could and should be like. So, how do we do this? Where do we go with this? A few weeks ago, when the last time I was here, I was talking about how do we abide in God, as you might recall. If you did it, you can go back to videos there. But it really is all about how do we choose more love in our lives? How do we get closer to Jesus? And the way you do it is you do it with prayer. You have a discipline of prayer and you continually pray more to Jesus. When we open up the building again and you're able to come back here, you receive communion. If you're unable to come here, we will bring it to you. But you are in relationship with us and you are in relationship with Jesus through it. It is through this relationship and working at it and being with it that your life will be transformed. Your life can be changed so much that you will feel as if though you are born again. Now, I don't know if I committed a heresy here today. I hope not. But even if I did, what follows is the creed. And that'll put us all back together. But in that creed, we do say that we believe in one God. And that's the relationship that we need to nurture. The Trinity is about relationship. God initiates that relationship. Will we say yes? Will we accept that outstretched arm that was on the cross and now begs to hold us and hug us and make us born again? Amen? Amen. And now let us together affirm our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, light from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he was born incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, she is worshipped and glorified. She has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Inspired by the Spirit, we now offer our prayers to God in the name of Jesus Christ, saying,
God, hear our prayer.
For the fulfillment of the mission of the Church, let us pray to the Lord.
God, hear our prayer.
For the liberation of the children of God from the bondage of fear, let us pray to the Lord.
God, hear our prayer.
For the consolation of all those who struggle with doubts or disbelief, let us pray to the Lord.
God, hear our prayer.
For renewed witness to the gospel among Christian people in positions of public trust, let us pray to the Lord.
God, hear our prayer.
For our assembly, as we hand on the faith of our ancestors from one generation to another, let us pray to the Lord.
God, hear our prayer.
For the power to live out the promise of our baptism, let us pray to the Lord.
God, hear our prayer.
For all the sick and suffering, the lonely and the dying, especially those we now name either silently or aloud. For Israel and Palestine. Let us pray to the Lord.
God, hear our prayer.
In the communion of the Holy Spirit with the Virgin Mary, with St. Paul the Hermit, and with all the saints in light, let us commend our lives and the lives of one another to Christ our Lord. Let us pray to the Lord.
God, hear our prayer. Almighty God, with tender love we call you Abba. Answer the prayers of your children gathered here, for we rely on you to have confidence in you. We ask this through Christ our Lord in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Now walk in love as Christ loved us and made himself a sacrifice acceptable to God. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is truly right to glorify you, Father, and to give you thanks. For you alone are God, living and true, dwelling in light inaccessible from before time and forever. Fountain of life and source of good, all goodness, you made all things and filled them with your blessing. You created them to rejoice in the splendor of your radiance. Countless throngs of angels stand before you to serve you night and day. And beholding the glory of your presence, they offer you unceasing praise. Joining with them and giving voice to every creature under heaven, we acclaim you and we glorify your name as we sing. Acclaim you, Holy Lord, glorious in power. Your mighty works reveal your wisdom and love. You formed us in your own image, giving the whole world into our care, so that in obedience to you, our Creator, we might rule and serve all your creatures. When our disobedience took us far from you, you did not abandon us to the power of death. In your mercy, you came to our help, so that in seeking you, we might find you. Again and again, you called us into covenant with you, and through the prophets, you taught us to hope for salvation. Father, you loved the world so much that in the fullness of time, you sent your only Son to be our Savior. Incarnate by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, he lived as one of us, yet without sin. To the poor, he proclaimed the good news of salvation. To prisoners, freedom. To the sorrowful, joy. To fulfill your purpose, he gave himself up to death, and rising from the grave, destroyed death and made the whole creation new. And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose for us, he sent the Holy Spirit, his own first gift for those who believe, to complete his work in the world and to bring to fulfillment the sanctification of all. When the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, his heavenly Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. At supper with them, he took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks once more, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Father, we now celebrate this memorial of our redemption, recalling Christ's death and his descent among the dead, proclaiming his resurrection and ascension to your right hand, awaiting his coming in glory, and offering to you from the gifts you have given us this bread and this cup. We praise you and we bless you.
We praise you, we bless you, we give thanks to you, and we pray to you, Lord our God.
Lord, we pray that in your goodness and mercy, your Holy Spirit may descend upon us and upon these gifts, sanctifying them and showing them to be holy gifts for your holy people, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that all who share this bread and cup may become one body and one spirit, a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your name. Lord, remember your one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church, redeemed by the blood of your Christ. Reveal its unity, guard its faith, and preserve it in peace. Remember Susan, our bishop, and all who minister in your church. Remember all your people and all those who seek your truth. Remember all who have died in the peace of Christ and those whose faith is known to you alone. Bring them into the place of eternal joy and light. And grant that we may find our inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, with patriarchs, prophets, apostles, martyrs, St. Paul of the Desert, and all the saints who have found favor with you in ages past. We praise you in union with them and give you glory through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, through him and with him and in him. It's through Christ and with Christ and in Christ. All honor and glory are yours, Almighty God and Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, forever and ever. And now, in the language of our hearts, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we pray. Padre nuestro que estás en el cielo, santificado sea tu nombre. Venga tu reino, hágase tu voluntad en la tierra como en el cielo. Danos hoy nuestro pan de cada día y perdona nuestras ofensas, como también nosotros perdonamos a los que nos ofenden. Y no nos dejes caer en la tentación y líbranos del mal. Porque tuyo es el reino, tuyo es el poder y tuya es la gloria, ahora y por siempre. Amén. Alleluia! Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us be pleased. Alleluia!
My friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of Christ bring me to everlasting life. The blood of Christ bring me to everlasting life.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Earlier, when I spoke about the five first books of Scripture, I mentioned them that they were the law. And in there is a blessing. It is known as the priestly blessing. And we're about to hear it from the choir, but I wanted to go ahead and also offer that blessing to you all. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you peace. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Amen. As his angels gave us a blessing. The Lord God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and the holy and undivided Trinity, guard you, save you, and bring you to that heavenly city where he lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Let us go forth in the name of God.
Thanks be to God.